hear from you today. Above all else, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good goodness. And we thank you for everything that you do in our lives, God. We want to worship you today, Lord, and I know that in this time and in this life, there's a lot of bad things. There's a lot of turmoil. There's a lot of hurt, and even in the church, God. And we know the world is looking. We know the world sees your church, God. So we just, this time, we want to praise you and lift you up, God, so that when people look at us, they see you. Holy Spirit, this is the time we're just going to praise your name. We're just going to sing your name, Lord. Holy Spirit, this is all about you. This is not about me. This is not about anybody in this room, God. Holy Spirit, we just want to sing a sweet, sweet aroma, Lord, that it'll be pleasing to you. That this will be a sacrifice. We're sacrificing our time, Lord, and that's such a small thing, God. But I just pray that we can lay down our hearts, lay down our thoughts, all the distractions, Lord, and we just want to lift you up right now in this time. Holy Spirit, we're just going to sing your praises and spend this time in your presence, God. Thank you, Father.
Holy, He is holy.
this love so rescuing. Oh, how infinitely sweet this great love that I is redeemed. Come on. As one we sing, alleluia, alleluia, he is holy, he is holy, alleluia, 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 he is holy.
This is
running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my eyes laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you every day. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered now, I give you every day. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Sing that again. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness. Goodness, Father. We like to dwell on the bad, Lord, but you are good. You are faithful. So, Lord, I just pray that this in this time, Lord, everyone in this room can just reflect on the goodness that you've given me. It's all around. You give us life, Lord. You give us love. Lord, you're just so good. So, Father, I just pray that this brother Jeff brings a message, Lord, that you use him, you speak through him, Lord. And if someone in this room doesn't know your goodness, doesn't know your love, Lord, let it just rush over them. We thank you, Father. We love you, Jesus. In your name.
Thank you, AJ, for leading us in our worship time. If you would, this morning, I would ask you to open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I know it's not. Oh, yeah, if you have any kids, fourth grade and down, want to go to children's church? They're leaving now. I think they got them all. I think. All right. But again, if you would turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, we're going to use that verse as a jumping off point and just try to share with you as God has placed on our heart. You did see the cover page there where it's talking about love. And again, we've been gone some between the mission trip and between camps. We've been gone some Sundays, and we do appreciate Brother Mike for filling in last week, and Brother Micah for filling in the week before. But in the in-betweens, we've been trying to share with you some things that God has really, and again, I can't think of any better way to say it other than just to say some things that God has burdened heavily in your pastor's heart, the importance of showing the love of Christ in all the different ways in our life that He enables us to share it. And so in sermons past, we've talked about loving through worship, loving through how you speak or loving through your words, loving through the fellowship of a body of believers, which I do believe is so very important, loving through your witness. And then we've got about three or four more areas that God has really kind of burdened me with that we're going to share over the next few weeks. But today we're going to talk about one that you probably don't think about and one you're probably not going to like. Just up front, I wrestled with the Lord. Wrestled, that's Kentucky for wrestle. We wrestle, starts with an R. But I wrestled with the Lord, wrestled with the Lord about and over this message time and time again. And even last night, as I was reviewing, just God, you know, help me to do this in the right way, with the right spirit. Because I know it's not something that you want to think about, and it's not something probably you're even comfortable thinking about, but it is loving through our work. Loving through our work. Now, before you teenagers say, "Well, I'm not working yet, I'm going to turn you off." Well, your work, your job is school. So it applies the same thing. It's what we do with our day. It's where we're at in our day. How we need to show a lost and dying world the love of Christ. And again, the place where you can impact the most, the place that you spend a whole lot more of your time than you want to, right? Some of you work 8, 10, 11, 12, 13 hours a day. You're there. You're with those people, honestly, more than you're with your family. Right? You're with those people a lot more than you're with your church family, sad to say. And so, again, these sermons have been birthed out of how we as a church and how we as Christians have to do a better job showing the love of Christ if we're going to impact. Now, I say we have to. Let me add this. If we're going to impact them in the right way, if we're going to do what God left us here to do, if we're going to do what we're called to do, we've got to figure out a way to show that love in a better way. And so, again, one of the more uncomfortable of the topics that God has given me to share with you is loving with our work. In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, it's a very familiar text. And he's talking about here, he's talking about food offered to idols and meat offered to idols. And so this first part is referring to that. He says, therefore, whether you eat or drink, okay? So he's talking about what he's been talking about. But listen to the last part, okay? Because he adds an or to it that says this is even more than what we've been talking about, meat offered to idols and having a good conscience and what you eat or what you don't eat. He says, therefore, whatever you eat or drink, or whatever, that's a big word, right? Not just because it's got a lot of letters in it. It's a big word. Whatever you do. Whatever you do. Do all to the glory of God. And like I just said, for a lot of you and for a lot of you today that are here, that whatever has a whole lot to do with work because of how much of the time it takes in your life. Whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we come before you very inadequate this morning. Very much burdened, but very much distracted. And God, I just give that to you. I've been trying to give it to you now over and over again for some days. Last night, throughout the day, yesterday, this morning, God, I give over that, those feelings that I have this morning, Lord God, of inadequacy, of distraction, of I don't know what. But God, I come before you this morning, and without a doubt, I know you've given me a message to proclaim. And so, God, even though I feel inadequate, even though I do feel distracted, God, I pray this morning that you would help me to share these words, share these thoughts, share these ideas that you've placed in our heart for this body of believers that are here today, for those who may be watching at home, for those who are going to watch maybe at a different time. God, I pray that you would help me in your strength and in your power to give me the strength and the power to do that which you've asked me to do. God, I pray that you would speak in a manifested way through the presence of the Holy Spirit, through a broken vessel, but a vessel that's yours nonetheless. And so, God, I just pray that as I try to share, God, what you've placed on my heart, what you've placed in my mind, that, God, you would direct every thought, every pattern, every word, and that as it's spoken, God, it would just bring honor and glory to you, and that, God, you would take it and your Spirit would run in this place. God, it would run through every person's heart, that which you want to run through their heart, to help them, to strengthen them, to draw them, to convict them, whatever it is, Lord God, you want to do. God, I pray today that you would do that. And I know you will, and I know you can, because of how strong your Holy Spirit power is. So, God, we ask that you do these things today, and that you use us in Christ's name. Amen. You see, we need to understand that we can all show the love of God and we can be the love of God every single day through our work. And I know for some of you that's strange and you're thinking, preacher, I don't know where you're going with this. And I'll be honest, I didn't either until God brought it all together. But I hope that you'll stick with me and see that it's important, but to understand how much this can impact a lost and dying world. The fact that we are able, that we should be capable, but even more than that, understanding that the Word of God compels us to show the love of God through our everyday actions. And for a large percentage of us, that is in our work life. That is in the job, in the mundane, right? Used to be 9 to 5. I bet some of y'all miss those days. Van, you'd love to have a 9 to 5 day, wouldn't you? Bless your heart, right? Some of you, Lance, on a farm, wouldn't you love to have a 9 to 5 day? Yeah, that'd be nice, wouldn't it? Don't happen, right? It just don't happen. And so this morning, I want us to look at some reasons that I can say that we can show the love of God through our work, or why we should show the love of God through our work. The first is this. Whether we like it or not, work is God's will. Whether we like it or not, whether we want to accept it or not, whether we like the idea, work is God's will. God wants us to work. Now, let me say this at the offset. Some of you might be disabled and not able. Some of you may be unemployed at the present time for whatever reason. Some of you may be retired. Some of you may be called to stay at home and be a stay-at-home mom. I'm thankful for the time that God finally convicted me and Missy enough that we were able to make all the sacrifices that we needed for her to be able to stay home with our kids. And so I understand that there are some things where some of you are trying, or Satan's trying to say, he ain't talking to you or this ain't about you. But listen, it is still about you. Because for those of you that are in those circumstances or have circumstances that keep you from working in a quote-unquote traditional sense, I still think all these principles can apply to you if you'll open your heart to them and let them apply to you in so many ways. You see, God gives us His instructions in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11. And I'm going to share a lot of scripture with you today, okay? So keep your outline. You can go back and judge it all later. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 11, it says, make it your goal to live a quiet life. Phew. That's good right there, isn't it? The next part's even better. Minding your own business. But then the next part's what we're looking at this morning. And working with your hands just as we have instructed you before. Right here in this scripture, he's telling us to strive for three things. And I'm telling you this morning, and I'm telling my own self in my own life, if we would strive for these three things, we might be surprised at what kind of impact it would have in our life. He says we're to strive for three things. One, to live a quiet life. Two, to mind your own business. And three, to work with your hands. Since the very beginning of time, I believe God has stressed the need for us as His people to not only work, but to embrace work, right? And I know some of you are going to say, well, it wasn't His intention until sin came into the world. Well, I agree with that. But since God already knew what was going to happen to begin with, I don't think we need to settle on that argument. God knew that in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, He was going to have to say, the Lord God placed the man in the Garden of Eden to tend and to watch over it. Sounds like He gave him a job. Doesn't it sound like it? Right? That's like He gave him a job. Because that was God's intention in our life. Even the very first humans had to work to tend and to watch over the garden. This leads me to believe that work is actually a very central part of our being. We were created to be people who work. In fact, God has a clear message for those who refuse to work in Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 to 11. This is a really, really interesting text. It says, take a lesson from the ants. They're pretty annoying, right? But it says, take a lesson from the ants, you lazy bones. Learn from their ways and become wise. Though they have no prince or no governor or ruler to make them work, they labor hard all summer gathering food for the winter. But you lazy bones, how long will you sleep? When will you wake up? A little extra sleep, a little more slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. Then poverty will pounce on you like a bandit. Scarcity or being in want will attack you like an armed robber. Excuse me. The Bible doesn't really pull any punches in some of this, and some more scripture I'm fixing to share with you in a moment. The Bible doesn't pull any punches. If we had more people with the habits of an ant, or the ants, then we would have a much more probably happy and productive society. But the larger point is this. Again, the larger point is this. God wants us to be laborers. God appoints us to be workers. It is the way He designed us. And when we choose not to work, it shows in that scripture in Proverbs that we'll reap the negative results. But I was reading from 1 Thessalonians earlier. Let me read from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 now. Verses 6 through 13. It says, now, dear brothers and sisters, we give you this command in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stay away from all believers who live idle lives and don't follow the traditions they receive from us. For you know that you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you. We never accepted food from anyone without paying for it. We worked hard day and night, so we would not be a burden to any of you. We certainly had the right to ask you to feed us, but we wanted to give you an example to follow. Even while we were with you, we gave you this command. Those unwilling to work will not get to eat. Yet we hear that some of you are living idle lives, refusing to work and meddling in other people's business. We command such people and urge them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and work to earn their own living. As for the rest of you, dear brothers and sisters, never get tired of doing good. So not only are we admonished to work, but it says to stay away from all believers who live idle lives. And this again might sound harsh to us, but it should drive home that point that I believe God takes this very, very seriously. We need to remember that the idle here are those who are not those who can't work, but those who refuse to work. And so we can see very simply that it is the will of the Lord for us to work. And as we work as unto Him. That verse that we jumped off of to begin with. Secondly, And this is where we're headed now, right? Understand that because God wants us to work, because God has desired for us to work, because so much Scripture implores us to work, to do what we're called to do, again, no matter what that may be, understand this. And you're going to get mad at me for this next statement, but if I don't say it, God's going to choke the life out of me. The reason we as Christians are having such a hard time reaching a lost and dying world with the very greatest news that we could ever share with them is because we as Christians don't work or live the lives that we ought to live in front of them. And so our second thought this morning is this. Work is actually our witness to the lost. Work is actually our witness to the lost. In my years of pastoring and preaching, you'd be surprised how many times I've had somebody who's come up to me and said, "Preacher, you know, I'm really burdened for such and such. I'm burdened for this co-worker. I'm burdened for this family member. I'm burdened for this child or son or daughter. I'm burdened for my mom or my dad or whoever it may be." And as we discuss and try to get to that point of praying over them, and I gently try to remind them, what kind of life are you living in front of them? It oftentimes brings up a point that none of us want to talk about. Right? We want them to do as we say, but not watch what we do. We want them to listen to the things that we spew, but yet don't pay attention to my life. We want to thump them in the head with the Bible, and then we want to ask them to clock us out 30 minutes early so we can run home and get somewhere. That's just a silly example, right? We want to reach some of our co-salespeople. I used to be in sales, so I'll use that. We want to reach some of our co-salespeople for Christ, and yet we all get together and lie on our expense reports. See where we're headed? Work and what God has called us to do is probably one of the hugest witnesses to the loss that we as Christians can have. That we actually do have. That we actually do have. Have you ever thought of your work in terms of how it can be used to reach those who do not know Christ? How you conduct yourself and the honesty and the integrity in which you do things, in which you are a person of your word, of your commitment, of your life. It has a huge impact on people that we are called to be salt and light for. Most of us don't think in terms like that. We don't want to think in terms like that because we kind of like the system that we have, right? In fact, many Christians in the work environment spend a lot of time complaining about work rather than working. And when we do that, what kind of example does that set? You know, we need to be fully aware that non-Christians at our places of work, at our places of business, whether you want to believe it or want to even hear it, are watching us to see if our work matches our faith, to see if our work matches our talk, to see if our work matches our t-shirts, our bumper stickers. They're watching. They're paying attention. You know, some of you probably think, you know, sometimes I harp on too much on, you know, what we laugh at, what we listen to, and what we watch. I know the youth that are here tonight, they think I harp on it way too much on Wednesday nights. But I'm telling you, to ever have credibility with a lost and dying world that you want to reach, you have to back up what you're proclaiming. And so I go back to the statement I made at the first of this point. One of the reasons that we're having such a hard time winning people to Christ is because we as Christians are not doing these things. We're not. We're laughing at what they're laughing at. We're watching what they're watching. We're cheating like they're cheating. Right? We're lying just like they're lying.
We're doing all the things that they're doing. And so why would there be anything about us or who we belong to that would draw them? We need to be fully aware that they're watching us. In other words, are we honest? Are we productive? Do we have a good attitude? Are we trying the best that we can to be a great employee or a great boss or a great supervisor? But even more than that, are we trying our best to be a great Christian employee or a great Christian boss or a great Christian businessman or businesswoman, salesman or saleswoman? I've got a friend, and I won't mention him by name, but I've got a friend who owns a car business. And God has blessed his business tremendously. And one of the pillars of his testimony is how God has radically changed. I know when you hear car dealer, right, you think crook, thief, right? But this guy just does it different. He just puts out cars. He has a margin that he's going to make. So whatever he pays, here's his margin. He'll show you why, where, and how he got to that margin. And that's just the way it is. He doesn't try to ever oversell. Even if somehow he runs into a $10,000 car, he gets it for three. Okay, I don't even remember now what the margin is. Let's say his margin is three. Even though he could get 10 for it, he still sells it for six. And everybody in the car business tells you they don't understand how he's been so successful. But man, God has blessed him tremendously. In the pillar of all of his buildings, he's got scripture written. Every time something's built, scripture is on the cornerstone. He's not ashamed of his faith. And he conducts it in a way that others know it. Now, he's probably not perfect. I'm sure he makes a lot of mistakes. I'm sure he sins daily like the rest of us do. But you understand the point, right? We ought to be that witness above reproach in everything we do. Do everything as unto the Lord. Everything as unto or to the glory of the Lord. We ought to have those type of attitudes because non-believers are watching. Paul tells us about the positive results for those who do work hard. Again, I go back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 12. It says, then people who are not Christians will respect the way that you live, and you will not need to depend on others. Can I tell you that I hear a lot of people, right? And I heard this, I wasn't in the conversation at youth camp, but I heard other youth leaders sitting and talking in a huddle. And people are always constantly talking about how they don't feel like people respect Christianity like they used to. Right? And I've heard some of you, well, it just seems like, preacher, that people don't respect the church like they used to. So we have two choices, right? We can blame the non-believers who don't understand or are part of it, right, and say, well, they just don't respect. Or we can look at us and say, are we doing what's necessary? Are we living in a way, are we doing the things that are necessary that they will respect the way that we live? Again, I knew there wasn't going to be a lot of amen in this morning. It's not going to be a popular sermon. That's why I beg God to not preach it. But it's true, is it not? The people who are not Christians will respect the way you live if you're living the way that you ought to live. They may mock you to your face. They may make fun of you. They may call you a Bible thumper or a holy roller. Wow, that'd be just terrible, wouldn't it? Right? Compared to what other Christians have gone through down through the ages, man, it'd be terrible to be called a name, wouldn't it? then people who are not believers will respect the way you live. It's an understanding of what Paul is saying are the positive results for those who work the right way, live the right way. Think about that, right? It's a silent witness. It's a silent witness. Many of us are afraid of actually telling others about Christ. A lot of you would never walk up to somebody at work and share John 3:16 through 18 with somebody. You would never go up to them and talk about the Romans road. You would never go up and share with them from Ephesians, for by grace are you saved through faith. You would never do that for whatever reason. But Paul tells us that by our work habits, we can gain the respect of non-Christians. Now, please hear me when I say that that's not a substitute for telling people about Christ, but we ought to look at that as pre-evangelism, right? In the 10 years, now almost 10 years that I've been your pastor, you've heard me talk about my big belief in relational evangelism, right? And when I got here, some of you, even some of you that have been in church a long time, you're like, I don't understand that term, and you asked me to explain it to you. And I explained to you the fact that in my relationship with Braden, why are you smiling at me? Did I say your name wrong? Okay. I never know sometimes what comes out of this mouth. In my relationship with Braden, through the time that I've been around him, I earned the right to share with him. Right? But it's pretty important that when I'm with Braden, that my life shows something that would make him go, maybe I should listen. You know, how I handle things, how I handle crisis, how I handle problems, how I handle issues, which I'm terrible at, right? Those things ought to give me the right. Now, I'm not saying don't go out and knock on doors. And if God leads you to knock on doors, praise God, go knock on doors, right? If God tells you to stand on a street corner and proclaim the gospel to everybody that passes by, praise God, do that. But don't just do those things and forget that your life matters. The everyday lost people in your life matter. There will come a time when eternity will start for every single one of them. And you might not could ever drag them into this building. But if you're at work with them, guess what? Unless they want to quit their job, right? When you're in the locker room with them, when you're in the classroom with them, they can't stop you from living the life. That even if they reject it, even if they say it's a bunch of hogwash, they're still going to see it. Still going to impact. And I promise you, because I have been there, it's going to make them go, wow, there's something different about her. There's something different about that guy. Right? And you may never mention John 3:16. It may just be that your life is so full of integrity that they go, why are they not like the rest of us? Amen? You have to be able to tell them, but sometimes you have to earn the right to tell them. Once I have gained, or once you have gained their respect, then they are more likely to hear what it is that you want to say, or what it when you want to share your faith, or when you want to invite them, or when you want to include them. They're a lot more willing to listen. In the book of Colossians chapter 4, Verses 5 and 6, it says, live wisely among those who are not believers. How many of you have people in your life that are not believers? Yeah, all of us. Forgot to raise your hand. Anyway, live wisely among those who are not believers and make the most of every opportunity. It'd be a different scripture if it just said make the most of the opportunity. Because then you could go, oh, well, yeah, I'll get another opportunity. Or I'll share it a different opportunity. But he doesn't let you off the hook, does he? He says, in every opportunity, live wisely among those who are not Christians and make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversations be gracious. Boy, and I like this next word. And attractive. Your speech, your words, your attitude. Let your conversation be gracious and attractive so that you will have the right response for everyone. Work is our witness to the lost. Thirdly, work is God's means of our provision. So let's look at a verse that we looked at moments ago, but pay a little closer attention to the second half. 1 Thessalonians 4:12. Then people who are not Christians will respect that way, the way that you live, and you will not need to depend on others. Not only will non-Christians set up and take notice, but you will be able to provide for your family and not need to be dependent on others. The Bible does make it very clear that we are to take care of those who can't take care of themselves, but this is talking about those who are able to work but won't. If you're able to work and the work is available, then you should be the hardest worker that can be found. And by doing so, you will not be dependent on anyone else, other people, or your family, or anyone else. Again, we're not talking about being rich, but we're talking about being able to provide the basic necessities of your life. And God says He's going to provide those, does He not? Most of the time, He provides those through the job. I can remember a time in my life when I would have probably prayed, Lord God, I need this done or need this prayer. And not thought of it that way, that I'd turn down a couple of jobs or chances to make some extra money. I'd be like, oh, God's going to take care of me. Yeah, God gave me the chances, and I missed them, right? But Paul sets an example for us in that regard. Look, in the book of Acts chapter 20, Paul sets this example to all of us, right? Everybody like to kind of be like the Apostle Paul, wouldn't they? Now, I'd like to have some Paul in me. I'd like to live a little better life. And look what Paul says. He says, I have never coveted anyone's silver or gold or fine clothes. It's a bold statement, isn't it? Today it would be, I've never coveted anyone's house or vacations, second homes, lake homes. I've never coveted their beach condos or their mountain condos. Right? I've never coveted their Air Jordans. I've never coveted their retirement. I've never recovered. You know, whatever. I've never coveted anyone's silver or gold or fine clothes. Know that these hands of mine have worked to supply my own needs and even the needs of those who are with me. And I have been a constant, this is a bold statement, I have been a constant example of how you can help those in need by working hard. You should remember the words of our Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Not only did he not depend on others, but he was about to help others who were in need. That is what we are called to do, again, as we show love through our work. How we can help and supply needs. How that we can support ministry, and we can support gospel, and we can support the Alabama Baptist Home for Children, and we can help support Show Save Alive. And yes, we can do that as a church, but you can do those things individually. How you can help others, how you can help send people to camp. I'll never get over, right, how I have never announced ever that I can remember, hey, we got kids that need sponsors at camp. If somebody would want to sponsor somebody at camp. I literally don't do that. But I've never had a year come by or pass by where somebody didn't come to me and say, hey, I just feel like somebody needs some help. Or they've sent me a text and say, hey, is there somebody, I feel like somebody needs help. And then they're willing to help. They're willing to help. About 7 times out of 10, that kid that I help normally either gets saved or makes some kind of decision that's just radical for the Lord. It's really cool to watch. It's really cool. And the ability to do that comes from our ability to work. Lastly, as I've shared all of these things, right, work is God's means of provision. Work is our witness. Work is God's will. I can't leave, I don't think, without God allowing me to share with you. In sharing all of that, okay, God's work must still be our priority. Now, that doesn't mean that you rob your employer because you're going around reading the New Testament to everybody in the building so that productivity stops. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying, God is saying, God's work must be our priority. Most of us do not work for the kingdom of God in the sense that that is where we derive our paychecks. Some of you work in a factory. Some of you work for yourself. Some of you work in office buildings. Some of you work from your home. But the one thing we all have in common is that we are called as believers to make God's work our first priority. That's why we work as unto the Lord. That doesn't mean that we have to spend all of our time at church or that we are to neglect the job that puts food on our table. But it does mean that God is number one in all that we do and that service to Him and His kingdom must be paramount. It must be first. You see, as I look back in my years of being on this earth, that's one of the dynamics that I have seen change in Christianity. If you were to be honest and write down in a list where your priorities are at, I don't know that you could be honest in putting God first. I don't know that I could be honest in putting God first in times in my life. Okay, and again, I'm not... Again, please don't turn me off. Please don't get mad at this. This is God trying to get your attention. Okay, this is God caring enough to try to stir you to action. Not just to hear a sermon, not to agree or disagree with a sermon, but for God to stir you to the point where He can do in your life what He wants to do in your life. God's work must be our priority. Because no matter how many years you get on this earth, no matter how many years that you have employment, right? We all try to get to that magical retirement age, right? So we can retire from work. We never retire from what God's called us to do. Right? I've heard my daddy preach it, and I've heard other preachers a lot better than me preach it, that nothing will make a pastor any more heartbroken, frustrated, or mad as to hear somebody go, "I've already served my time, let somebody else do it." Why in the world is God leaving you here then? If you've already served your time and you've already done all for the kingdom of God that you can accomplish, why didn't He take you home? I'll tell you why. Because there's still more to do. There is no retirement plan in the kingdom of God. There's a great benefit when you die, but there's no retirement plan. You continue to serve. You continue to serve. You continue to serve if God's work is your priority. Now, if God's work's not your priority, guess what? You'll look for any excuse not to do any work for the kingdom of God. That went over really good. I'm sure it did. But it's still the truth. Right? This is what I'm coming to realize really fast, Lance. Truth really doesn't go over well most of the time. Most people don't want truth. They want a candy-coated version of the truth that makes them feel better about themselves. They don't want truth. But the truth of the matter is God's work must be our priority. Most of us don't work for the kingdom of God, but it doesn't change the fact that God's work ought to be at the forefront of all that we're doing and in how we conduct ourselves and how we work and how we go about our day. God is number one in all that we do. And service to Him ought to be number one in the things that we do. Some of you go, "That's easy for you because you're a preacher. That's your job to do. It's your job to do." I wish you could understand what that call, it's not a job, what that call is like. But it still, if I quit pastoring today, right? If I literally at the end of this service said, "I am resigning as pastor of First Baptist Church, Lexington," it still wouldn't change the fact that for Jeff Cruse, God's work has to be a priority. You understand what I'm saying? Does it change that fact? Whether I'm volunteering to coach a baseball team, whether I'm doing baseball lessons, where I'm taking kids to camp, whether I'm taking youth to camp, whether I'm on a mission trip to Nicaragua, whether I'm at the store at Big Star, no matter what, does it change the fact? that God's work must be our priority. And again, if we want to be really honest today, okay, and I know we probably don't, but if we wanted to be really honest today, we'd have to admit that this is just not true anymore in the lives of a majority of Christians. Now, God's work is important. God's work is valuable. God's work is prudent. Right? God's work is, I'll use the same word again, God's work is important to me. But that ain't enough. Lots of things are important to me that I don't do anything about. Amen? Right? Lots of things are important to me that I never do anything about them. If it's a priority for me, guess what? Won't nothing stop or keep me from being about it. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, you know all so well. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. Right? In the older translations, New King James Version, it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Now, I don't know about you guys, but that kind of sounds like an order. That kind of sounds like a command, doesn't it? I mean, because there's no, you know, if you have time, seek the kingdom of God, or if you want to seek the kingdom, if you can fit it into your busy schedule, because all of y'all are so busy, right? We're all so busy. It doesn't say that. It says seek the kingdom of God above all else. And or, again, the other translation, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And then he'll take care of the rest. Some of you know that to be true because you've had moments in your life when this was a priority for you and God did back up everything he promised you. And then somewhere along the line you forgot about it and you went about trying to take care of yourself. And so all of a sudden, God's kingdom was no longer a priority. When you and I are at work, we need to be doing it for the kingdom of God. When you and I are at home, we need to do everything to the glory of God. When you and I are out and about, it is the kingdom of God that should be the foremost in our mind and in our heart. The specific work that we are called to do for the kingdom of God is to reach those who do not know him yet. Now, I share this every year when we go to camp. We talk about it every year when we go to camp. It's so easy to serve the Lord while you're there. It's so easy to think about the things of the Lord when you're there because it is paramount in everything that you do. And what we try to express, and I think the youth will back me up on this, we try to express when you go home, it can still be this way, right? But you got to make it this way because you're no longer going to have a small group leader. You're no longer going to have large group, small group Bible study where somebody else is pouring into you. You've actually got to do it for yourself. Small group, large group Bible study for yourself. You've got to study for yourself. You've got to choose what you listen to, right? Instead of listening to some of the things that you listen to, you're no longer going to have worship music played for you. So you've got to choose what you're going to listen to. You've got to choose that you're going to serve. You've got to choose that you're going to pay attention. You've got to choose that you're going to love other people. You've got to choose those things in your life. Matthew chapter 9, verses 36 and 38, the last scripture I'm going to share with you this morning. Jesus said, or God's word says, when he, being Jesus, saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he turned to his disciples and he said, truly, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who's in charge of the harvest and ask him to send more workers into his field. Okay? I hadn't planned on doing this, but right now I just feel compelled to look at this verse and dissect it a little bit. Okay? It says, when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. What do you think Jesus up in heaven right now as he looks down on this earth? Do you think any of that's changed? I mean, isn't that good? Isn't that good words to describe people today? Confused and helpless, confused and helpless. And surely to goodness, if Jesus had compassion back in those days, surely to goodness, if Jesus had compassion in those days, He's looking down at our world right now going, "Oh, Father, we need workers. We need an army. We need harvesters. We need laborers. We need waterers. We need planters. We need people for this helpless and confused generation to go out and spread the truth, to live the truth, to be the truth." He looked at his disciples and said, "The harvest is great, but the workers are few." Can I look at you this morning again? Now, this is not in my notes, so you just got to blame God and the Holy Spirit. Okay? Listen to your pastor right now. You ready? There are way too few laborers. In this house and in every house like it. Far too few. There's far too few that are willing to make God's work a priority, to make God's will a priority, to put God's kingdom first. There's far too few. So He tells us what to do. Pray to the Lord of the harvest and ask Him to send more work. So I'm going to ask you that. But I'm going to ask you this in a way that, again, the Holy Spirit's just trying to get me in trouble today, I guess. I want you to pray that if you're a worker. But if you're not a worker, don't pray the Lord of the harvest, because you ain't yet doing your part. But if you're a laborer, if you're a worker, you join your pastor in begging God to send laborers. People that care. People that care about the community, that care about this church, that care about the ongoing and the outgoing and the keeping up and the mundane and the little bitty things. Pray that God will send more. He'll send more teachers. And then He'll send more students to be in that. Right? Y'all realize we still have Sunday school at 9 o'clock, right? Sunday nights, Wednesday nights. All that Bible teaching, all those things are going on for you, right? Somebody reminded me this morning, you know, the Bible does tell us as parents, right, raise up your children in the way that they'll go, they ought to go. I've never understood why those of us that was brought up through Sunday school, through discipleship training, through RAs or GAs or whatever else it may be, who were brought up through Awana, and because we were brought up through that stuff, it stayed with us to the point that we're here now, don't care enough to bring our kids to the very things that impacted us. I'll never understand it. You say, "Preacher, you're mad." I'm not mad. I am heartbroken. I am burdened beyond belief. I am cast down. I carry the weight of it. And I don't understand. And again, whether you like it or not, I love you enough to tell you the truth and let you do with it what you want. Are you willing to be one of the workers who sent out in the harvest field? Are you one of the people who will step up to the plate and say, "I serve God and His kingdom above all else, and I'm willing to do whatever God calls me to do"? If so, then you're the answer to the prayer that Jesus prayed, the answer that His disciples prayed. Not only then, but now down through the ages. If you're willing to seek first the kingdom of God, if you're willing to live the example and be the example in your workplace as you go out to that mundane job, right? Some of you are blessed, right? You have a job that doesn't feel like work. You're blessed. Some of you aren't. It doesn't matter which way it is, though, honestly. How you do it is important. And we need to be doing it as unto the Lord. And so I realized this morning that as we approach this subject, as we talk about work, most don't see it as a spiritual topic. But I hope today God's showed you and God's enabled you to see that this is a very much a spiritual topic. How many of you, don't raise your hand, but how many of you work at least 40 hours a week or more? That's a big chunk of your life. That if you don't look at it as a spiritual thing, that's a big chunk of your life that's not a spiritual thing. Does that make sense? And it's supposed to be a spiritual thing. Everything that we do, we should do to the glory of God. The way that we work for a living and the work that we do for the kingdom says a whole lot about the relationship that we have with God. I'm going to ask AJ to come. Give us a time for you to be able to respond. How we treat, how we work, how we go about our lives says everything about our relationship with the Lord. And so this morning, I wonder today if maybe there's some Christians here that need to do business with God about the business of their life. There's some of you today that are here that are Christians that need to do business with God about your work life, about the priorities, about your student life, about your athletic life, about your retired life. I just wonder if you're maximizing it, or if maybe today God has showed you some things that maybe you should change. Maybe some things that need to change. Maybe some thoughts or some ideas. Maybe some commitments that you need to make. I don't know what God's doing in your heart. But I know that I need to give you a chance to respond. So, are you an example to the lost coworker? Are you a shining light in a dark place? Are you leading them to truth, or are you pushing them away from the truth? The altar is yours. In your business dealings and the things that you do, are you an example of Christ-likeness? If not, would you get those things right with the Lord today? Lost person, I know today has not been a typical sermon about salvation. But again, from my own experience, when you come to church and you get convicted over the fact that you're lost, it doesn't matter what the preacher preaches. Today you can be saved. The blood that Jesus shed for you, He shed for you. And if He's convicting you of your lostness, if He's been convicting you of your lostness, maybe some of you, maybe there's some youth here that went to camp and you've been battling it. Maybe there's some adults here that's been battling it. And you know today you're lost. Would you not be saved? Right, none of the rest of this makes any sense. You know why it doesn't make any sense? Because you're lost. How could you possibly live your life for Christ when you've not given your life to Christ? Amen? So as AJ plays or AJ sings, whatever God places on his heart, I just want you to know the altar's open. I'm going to ask you to stand, head bowed, eyes closed. Don't be a hindrance to anyone. If you need prayer, come and pray. If you need confession, come confess. If you need to come make something public, come make something public. Whatever it is that you need to do today, would you just do it? Would you just do it?